Stop it.
He is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moved us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask these things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with pure heart and humble voice under the throne of heavenly grace, saying together, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou those, O God, who confess their faults. Restore thou those who are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for this sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen.
God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of the sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people being penitent the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all those who truly repent and have faithfully believed his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
O Lord, open thou our lips,
and our mouths shall show forth thy praise.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Amen. Praise ye the Lord.
The Lord's name be praised.
Alleluia. The Lord is risen indeed.
Come, let us worship and adore him. Alleluia.
Let us join together, saying for the night. O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the strength of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving, and show ourselves glad in him with songs. For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods.
In his hand are all the corners of the earth, and the strength of the hills is his also. The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands prepared the dry land. O come, let us worship and fall down, and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is the Lord our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let the whole earth stand in awe of him. For he cometh to judge the earth, and the righteousness to judge the world, and the peoples with his truth. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Portion of the Psalter appointed for today is Psalm 23, just found on page 368 of the Book of Common Prayer, that is read responsibly by half persons. The Lord is my shepherd.
Therefore can I lack nothing.
He shall feed me in a green pasture,
and lead me forth beside the waters of comfort.
He shall convert my soul,
and bring me forth in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake.
Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil.
For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff comfort me.
Thou shalt prepare a table before me in the presence of them that trouble me.
Thou shalt anoint my head with oil, and my cup shall be full.
Surely thy loving kindness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be,
world without end. Amen.
Here begins the 19th verse of the second chapter of the first letter of the Apostle Peter. This is thankworthy if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully. For what glory is it if, when you be buffeted for your faults, you shall take it patiently? But if, when you do well and suffer for it, you take it patiently. This is acceptable to God. For even here unto were you called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps, who did no sin, neither was God found in his mouth. Who, when he was reviled not again, when he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed, for ye were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls. Here endeth the first lesson. Together today on our office, which is found on page 10 of the Book of Common Prayer.
angels cry aloud, the heavens
hold ours therein.
To thee, cherubim and seraphim continually do cry, Holy, 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 Lord God of Sabaoth. Heaven and earth are full of the majesty of thy glory.
The
glorious company of the apostles praise thee. The goodly fellowship of the prophets praise thee. The noble army of martyrs praise thee. The holy church throughout all the world doth acknowledge thee. The Father of an infinite majesty, thine adorable, true, and only Son, also the Holy Ghost, the Comforter. Thou art the King of glory, O Christ.
Thou art the everlasting Son of the Father, whom thou didst upon me to deliver man. Thou art the Son of thyself, to be born of a virgin.
When thou hast overcome the sharpness of death, thou didst open the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Thou sittest at the right hand of God in the glory of the Father.
We believe that thou shalt come to judge. We therefore pray thee, help thy servants, whom thou hast redeemed with thy precious blood.
Make them to be numbered with thy saints in glory everlasting.
O Lord,
save thy people and bless thine heritage. Govern them and lift them up forever. Day by day we magnify thee, and we worship thy name forever without end. Vouchsafe, O Lord, to keep us this day without sin. O Lord, have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us. O Lord, let thy mercy be upon us, as our trust is in thee. O Lord, in thee have I trusted. Let me never be confounded. Was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Here we begin at the 11th verse of the 10th chapter of the Gospel according to the Apostle John. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. But he that is the hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf come in and leaveth the sheep and fleeth, and the wolf catcheth them and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth, because he is an hireling and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and am known of mine, even as the Father knoweth me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. Here in the first lesson. Say that we come to the United States, found on page 14, for the common prayer.
Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up a mighty salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets,
which have been since the world began, that we should save to our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy he promised to our forefathers, and to remember his holy covenant, to perform the oath which he sware to our forefathers, Abraham, that he may give us,
that
we being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And thou, child, shalt be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people for the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Continue in our service and reciting the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ,
his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father.
From thence he shall come to judge the quick
and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O Lord, show thy mercy upon us,
and grant us thy salvation.
O God, make clean our hearts within us.
And take not thy Holy Spirit from us.
Almighty God, who has given thine only Son to be unto us, both a sacrifice for sin and also an example of godly life, give us grace that we may always most thankfully receive that as most inestimable benefit, and also daily endeavor ourselves to follow the blessed step of his most holy life, through the same thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God, who art the author of peace and lover of comfort and knowledge, and who standeth our eternal life, whose service is perfect for you, defend us, thy humble servants, and all the souls of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in thy defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty, everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings, being ordered by thy governance, may be righteous in thy sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O most mighty, merciful God, in this time of grievous sickness, we flee unto thee for succor. Deliver us who deceive thee from our peril. Give strength and skill to all those who minister to the sick. Prosper the means made use of for their cure. And grant, perceiving how frail and uncertain our life is, we may apply our hearts unto that heavenly wisdom which leadeth to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, Heavenly Father, give us grace to trust thee alone during this time of illness and distress. In mercy, put an end to the epidemic that afflicts us. Grant relief to all those who suffer, comfort all those that mourn, sustain all those engaged in the ministry of medicine and healing, in their labors, and cause thy people ever to serve you in righteousness and holiness, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord God, we confess to you that we deserve your fatherly chastisement for our sins, yet we earnestly implore thee for thy name's sake to spare us in this time of disaster, for sparing all harmful powers, and help thy suffering people with your word may be declared faithfully and without hindrance, and that we, amending our sinful lives, may walk in safety and peace according to thy holy commandments. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord our Heavenly Father, the high and mighty ruler of the universe, who dost from thy throne behold all the dwellers upon the earth, most heartily we beseech thee with thy favor to behold and bless thy servant Donald, the President of the United States, and all others in authority, and so replenish them with the grace of thy Holy Spirit, that they may always incline to thy will and walk in thy way. And do them plenteously with heavenly gifts, and grant them in health and prosperity long to live. And finally, after this life, to attain everlasting joy and felicity through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty everlasting God, from whom cometh every good and perfect gift, send down upon our bishops and other clergy, and upon the congregations committed to their charge, the helpful spirit of thy grace, and as they may truly please thee, pour upon them the continual doom of thy blessing. Grant this, O Lord, for the honor of our advocate and mediator, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
O God, the creator and preserver of all mankind, we humbly beseech thee for all sorts and conditions of men, that thou wouldst be pleased to make thy ways known unto them, by saving health unto all nations. More especially we pray for thy holy church universal, that it may be so guided and governed by thy good spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led in the way of truth, and hold the faith and unity of spirit in the bond of peace and the righteousness of life. Finally, we commend to thy fatherly goodness all those who are in any ways afflicted or distressed in mind, body, or estate. That it may please thee to comfort and relieve that according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their sufferings, and happy issue out of all their afflictions. And this we beg for Jesus Christ's sake.
Amen.
And now saying together with general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies,
We, thine unworthy servants, do give thee most humble and hearty thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men. We bless thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for thine inestimable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ,
through the
grace and hope of glory.
And we
beseech thee to give us that due sense of all thy mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we show forth thy praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to thy service, and by walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication unto thee, and has promised that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant the request. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come life everlasting. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all evermore.
Amen. Good morning.
Buenos dias.
I welcome all of you who are with us via the internet this morning. All of our communities and friends joining us in worship on this second Sunday after Easter. I pray that each of you is doing well. We pray for all those who are ill, all those who are in need because of the ongoing pandemic and its effect on our society. We plan to continue our streaming of services as long as this continues, and we welcome all those who are joining us for the first time. I remind all of our communities and friends and others that Father Jones and I remain available for pastoral needs. Please contact us. You can message us. You can call us. You can email us. And we will be glad to try and do what we can for the needs you may have as they arise. We hope to resume our regular schedule of services as soon as possible, and we await the announcement that should be made by the end of this week by Governor Abbott about possible easing of some of the restrictions that we're currently under. At such time as larger gatherings are allowed, we will, with appropriate modifications and safeguards, begin worship again in the church, at least for next Sunday and possibly the Sunday after that, we'll be continuing with the present format. Please pray that things will improve enough soon that we can begin to return to normal. Let us know if you find the streaming of our services useful. We appreciate your suggestions. And within the limitations of the equipment we're using, we will take those things to heart. But we think that right now this is the very best way that we can reach as many of you as possible. And I want to thank everyone who has made this possible, particularly Father Lawrence Jones and his son Nathan. This time we will have the proclamation of the word. In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. I am the Good Shepherd. On the second Sunday after Easter, in Anglican circles, This Sunday's long been unofficially called Good Shepherd Sunday because the emphasis of the collect and the lessons, what we call the Sunday Propers, emphasize this most familiar image of Christ as our Good Shepherd. In the early Middle Ages, when most of the present lectionary was originally compiled, the image of the shepherd and sheep and what was entailed in being a shepherd was still part of everyday culture. Everyone was familiar at a personal level with the issues involved in the keeping, raising, caring for, and protecting sheep. Even city dwellers were not so far removed. Being a shepherd is the model of offering total commitment. Shepherding sheep is not a part-time or casual occupation. It requires the total commitment of a person, body and soul, to the mission. Now here in Texas, we live in cattle country. Cattle, unlike sheep, are tough survivors. They can simply be turned loose on a range and move around in small, dissipated groups. I'm descended from a family of West Texas ranchers. And if you know how rugged that countryside is, you know cattle have to be survivors. And cattle will prosper if sufficient food and water is present. They're big enough that only the boldest predators, like mountain lions, will willingly tangle with healthy cattle. But sheep, on the other hand, are essentially helpless, and they require constant attention, lest they fall victim not only to predators, but simply wander off because of a lack of common sense. We're not given the image of Christ as that of the cowboy or the rancher, but rather the image of the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd who cares for his sheep. When Jesus says, "I am the Good Shepherd," we need to understand what distinguishes a good shepherd from a bad shepherd, and that is the level of commitment in their care for the sheep. There's an old saying among rural Southern folk that says the cure is in the care. Mothers know that loving care is a big part in encouraging a sick child. When we were small, the fact that someone cared for us was such a total commitment to us, even when we were ill, not only made us feel better, but it is a permanent attachment of love between the caregiver and the receiver. To care is to exhibit concern, to render aid, even to sacrifice for us. We speak of the uniqueness of a mother's love. Such devotion or service always costs something of ourselves. And it primarily falls to mothers. And I'm not saying anything negative about fathers, but it is just the way things are, that all too often it is the mother who, night after night, goes sleepless with a sick infant. So God, our Father, with all his masculinity, still gives us, through his Son Jesus Christ, the kind of love that we associate with a mother for a child. The Good Shepherd is thus the shepherd who deeply cares for his sheep. The meaning of that term care is that he is totally responsible. In the case of Jesus, he actually lays down his life for the sheep. That is the ultimate sacrifice, the total giving of oneself for the good of another. It is this type of love that we see Jesus exhibit in all the lessons in the weeks leading up to Easter. Sadly, in this year of the coronavirus, we miss all those Lenten services. We miss all of Holy Week. But suffice to say that during the Lenten season, and particularly focused during Holy Week, we are confronted with our own inability to measure up as the chosen children of God, and to love God and to love each other the way God loves us. On the other hand, we are asked to contemplate the sacrificial love of Christ, who alone, at the will of his Father, accomplishes what must be done to restore us,
to a full and right relationship with God. Thus the care manifests itself in the cure. The cross is the measure of how much Jesus cares for us. And the blotting out of our sins and condemnation are the means made use to effect our cure. And the resurrection is the cure, for we obtain eternal life in Christ. His promise is, as he rises, so will we. The good shepherd, then, is the shepherd who truly cares. And it's a great and wonderful paradox from God that Christ, who is simultaneously the Lamb of God as well as the shepherd, fulfills both of those roles, just as he is priest and sacrifice. His sacrifice is therefore not only the cure of our sins, but also imparts the care of our lives. The pastoral ministry of the church is rooted in this sense of care, which is often called the cure of souls. We have a course by that title in the seminary. It goes beyond the superficial and external matters of merely offering comfort of saying, "There, there." It is that we are to be physicians trying to administer the cure, which is Christ, to the spiritual illness of our souls. The disenchantment of our hearts and the despair we sometimes find in our lives in life's darkest moments. There is no pastoral care without the naming of the cure, and there is no cure without the acknowledgement of our need to be cured as being at the very root of our being. Lent and Holy Week focus upon our need to have a remedy for sin, a cure, and the sacrificial love of Jesus is that remedy. But now Easter and its message of hope and the resurrection also demonstrates to us that Christ's sacrificial love is a living love. It is love eternally in action, because the love of Christ for his people never ends. That love belongs to the divine life of Christ in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. A divine love that is made visible in the passion and the crucifixion of Christ, but also in the wonder of the resurrection. Today's collect, as so marvelously puts it, he is both a sacrifice for sin and also an example of godly life. He is the sacrifice for sin. He is the cure, the good shepherd who gives his life to the sheep, who stands between us and the wolf. He is the shepherd who wills to be struck, not only to protect us and prevent us from being scattered, but also that he may gather us unto himself. He gathers us through his care for us. He cares for us through his cure for us, an offering of himself, and he draws us to him. Jesus lays down his life not simply because he's a good shepherd, but because the condition of his being the good shepherd first and foremost is that he knows his sheep, and in his knowing and being known of the Father, he knows each of us individually. Everything is drawn into this knowing love of the Trinity. This relation, this mysterious relationship of the Son to the Father, that establishes the real context for the meaning of Christ as the Good Shepherd. He cares for the sheep because we belong to him. Thus, we are not our own. We are his, and that alters the whole question of relationship and care. It has all together to do with the nature of our humanity as being made in the image of God. When we look at ourselves in the mirror, and in our relationships, we tend to forget and deny this. We deny the very principle of being made in God's image, which alone gives us hope and dignity of our very being. Because we belong to Christ, he cares for us. Because he cares for us, he lays down his life for us. By his stripes are we healed, as Isaiah says. He is our cure, and he has risen for our justification. His life becomes our life, and our lives are hidden in him. Thus, he is an example of godly life. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow in his steps. What Christ has done for us in his free offering of himself is our justification. Justification is his cure for us. It then becomes the measure of his life at work in us, what we call sanctification, from his ongoing care for us. The challenge for us then is to embrace it. Our self-identity must be seen through being members of his flock, the church, the body of Christ. And this interplay between cure and care, between justification and sanctification, is crucial to a right relationship with God and to the distinctive characteristics of our Anglican way of Christianity. The Anglican witness as being Catholics with a lowercase c. Unfortunately, there are always among us, as in every religious body, there are revisionists and liberals and others who say they are going to walk apart from the received doctrine and discipline of the church. They are saying that little groups of sheep can exist apart from the shepherd and the flock and go off on their own way. But individual sheep, or even little groups of sheep, wandering off down strange paths without the shepherd or with false shepherds are easy prey for the wolf. The wolf being seen symbolically as Satan. Sheep may safely graze only under the eye of the true shepherd. Heterodox bishops and other clergy who advocate strange teaching, novel, secular doctrines that cannot be squared with Scripture, or advocate teachings and practices that were condemned by the Protestant reformers, including the English reformers, are not caring for the sheep. They are pursuing narrow and self-serving agendas. Those who go along to get along may protest that they are trying to protect their flocks, but in reality, they are protecting themselves. Our goal as under-shepherds is to be shepherds of our sheep. As Anglican Christians, our unity is found in Holy Scripture as the Word of God that contains all things necessary for salvation, in the sacraments of the Lord's Supper and baptism, the unbroken tradition of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church as understood through the 39 Articles. For that reason, the Reformed Episcopal Church has always sought the greatest possible unity with all Orthodox Anglicans while insisting that it must uphold Reformed Anglican Catholicity. We affirm the Bible as the ultimate rule of faith and as the inspired Word of God, the four historic ecumenical councils, the three creeds, and the ministry of bishop, priest, and deacon as being given by Christ. But all of this is incomplete unless we come together as the flock under the care of the Good Shepherd, which first and foremost means obeying his teaching. It is his word that must be proclaimed. It is his sacraments that must be celebrated only among those who are in his flock. Here is his cure, his care and cure for us. Where the word and the sacraments are faithfully proclaimed and celebrated, where the church, without which there is no care and no cure, meets. Jesus Christ is the good shepherd, the shepherd of our souls, through the church, his body, by which he gives us his word and the tangible and effective signs of his care for us. In his sacraments, his care is rooted in his love for us. And that love is our cure. Quite simply, Jesus is our cure who cares for us, provided that we hear the voice of the one who says, I am the good shepherd, and follow in the path that he would have us walk, and not seek our own trail in life. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. pray. Assist us mercifully, O Lord, and these our supplications and prayers, and dispose the way of thy servants toward the attainment of everlasting salvation, that among all the chances and changes of this mortal life, they may ever be defended by thy most gracious and ready help, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be all glory forever and ever. Amen.